What does a disused rackets court beneath the stands of a college football stadium in downtown Chicago, USA, have in common with a set of pipes leading up a Norwegian mountainside? Or come to that, what do they both have in common with a sandy waste on the banks of the majestic Columbia River in the Pacific far northwest? Or with a workbench in a dismal, long-since-bombed laboratory in what is now West Berlin? Or with a former ranch school set amid cottonwood trees atop an isolated plateau near the Rio Grande in New Mexico? This. That the world has never been and never will be the same since those first atomic explosions is a well-worn cliché, yet a cliché well worth repeating. For most of us, the dawn of the nuclear age was as much surprising as frightening, as much breathtaking as bewildering. New phrases like splitting atoms and going critical, new words like fallout and nuclear fission entered our everyday speech without our really knowing what they signified. We talked casually of mushroom clouds and megaton deaths, of atomic piles, of nuclear reactors. Yet behind all this upsurge of jargon, behind this new terrifying stage in man's development, lies one of the most fascinating stories of all time. The story of the making of the first atom bombs. It's a story that could begin at creation itself, but we choose to begin it in the closing days of 1938, the year of Munich, and of this. December 1938 was an unhappy month for the Jews of Germany. Hitler's Nazis were forcing them to deposit their wealth in special bank accounts that were to be used to pay off the multi-million pound fine summarily imposed on them for the alleged murder in Paris of a minor Nazi diplomat by a Jewish boy. But this was only another twist of the screw of Jewish persecution in Germany. Nazi oppression of Jews had, of course, been building up ever since Hitler had come to power in Germany in 1933. The persecution had already driven many prominent German Jews from the country, philosophers, artists, writers, but particularly scientists, among them the world's best-known scientist, a Jew, Albert Einstein. Like Einstein, many of these Jewish scientists were also nuclear scientists. Indeed, they included some of the world's most expert nuclear scientists, and mercifully for mankind, they chose not to stay in Nazi Germany. Einstein went to the United States, as did many others. Some fled to Britain and to Canada and to Sweden. Thus, by December 1938, a mere 9 months before World War II began, the Nazis had managed to denude Germany of many of her best nuclear scientists. And yet, it was in December 1938, in Hitler's capital of Berlin, that a certain Dr. Otto Hahn split the nucleus of the uranium atom and launched the world on the nuclear age. Within weeks, Hahn's experiments had been repeated in Russia, America, Poland, Denmark, and Britain. But it was here in Paris, at the Collège de France, that a team of French nuclear scientists, under Nobel Prize winner Frédéric Joliot-Curie, son-in-law of Madame Curie, discoverer of radium, showed how the enormous energy released in splitting the uranium atom could be harnessed either for industrial power in peace or as a terrible explosive in war. Such was Joliot-Curie's progress that by mid-1939 he'd already taken out patents, the first anywhere in the world, for the construction of a nuclear reactor and for the building of a uranium bomb. A bizarre instance of how the niceties of the private enterprise system were still being faithfully followed in that final summer before total war engulfed Europe. Until now, uranium had been merely a metal powder that occasionally burst into flame spontaneously, a scientific curiosity. But in May 1939, the British government, in the person of Sir Henry Tizard, their scientific advisor, recognizing uranium's new strategic importance, tried to buy from the Belgians an option on the world's most available source in the Congo. On being turned down, Tizard warned of the dangers of the uranium falling into hostile hands. As it happened, though neither Tizard nor anyone else among the Allies knew at the time, some 600 tons did fall into German hands when Belgium surrendered. But this fear that by having Otto Hahn and his team in their midst, the Nazis might make an atom bomb first, was the constant spur for nuclear researchers, not just in Britain and France, but in the United States too, where a group of refugee scientists persuaded Einstein in August 1939 to write a letter to President Roosevelt pleading that America should make an atom bomb, and fast. But the move evoked little immediate response. Within the month, Europe was plunged into war. The fears of the refugee scientists were certainly justified, for just a few weeks before Hitler attacked Poland, a secret conference of Germany's remaining nuclear physicists had been held under Nazi auspices in Berlin. What is more, alone of the warring powers, Germany established a department of the army devoted exclusively to the study of the military applications of nuclear fission. Worse still, she also possessed Europe's only uranium mine in Czechoslovakia. In Britain, in the early days of the war, nuclear research had a low priority, much lower, for instance, than radar research, which was of almost obsessional interest to Britain in view of her nearness to Germany and hence vulnerability to attack from the air. As a result, most British scientists were immediately detailed for radar research, or else for work on such other problems of obvious concern to the fighting services as magnetic mines and underwater detection. Indeed, such was the critical regard of this work that non-British citizens were rigorously excluded, and hence aliens, like those Jewish nuclear scientists who had recently fled from Nazi Germany, were left idle, or rather free, to unravel the secrets of atomic fission. In addition, most of Britain's top statesmen, while admitting the theoretical possibility of an atom bomb, were entirely sceptical of its practical probability, certainly within their lifetime. Churchill, for one, at this time, thought talk of atom bombs was bad for morale. Indeed, that it was a ruse of enemy propagandists to reduce the British and French people's will to resist. Many scientists, too, particularly in America, had their doubts. But suddenly, in February 1940, with the phony war at its height, the deriding Thomases were dealt a death blow. Two refugee scientists working in Britain, Rudolf Piles and Otto Frisch, calculated that if instead of uranium proper, its most fissionable isotope, so-called uranium-235, was used in the bomb, the amount needed to trigger off an explosion would not be the tens of tons hitherto thought, but merely a few pounds. Dramatically, the making of an atom bomb, and more importantly, carrying it in an airplane, was now undoubtedly feasible.
The immediate feeling was, of course, shock that the possibility of a practical weapon that everybody, including ourselves, had regarded as extremely remote, now seemed to be quite real, and it was obviously quite important to do something about it. It was clearly difficult and an enormous effort, but also the consequences so important that it would be worth the effort. We said at the time to ourselves, well, even if the cost of this project was as much as a battleship, it would be worth having. Well, that turned out to be rather an underestimate. I think you could have had very many battleships for what this cost.
But obtaining even a few pounds of U-235 for a bomb was a staggering task, for only 7 atoms of it exist among every 1,000 of pure uranium. And so far, no one had even been able to refine pure uranium. Since each stage of separating it simply enriched the existing U-235 by less than 1%, several 1,000 stages would be needed, each a technological complex in itself, so that the plant as a whole would be bordering on the fantastic.
Well, the essential difficulty is the extreme reactivity of uranium hexafluoride, which is the gas used to separate the uranium isotope. It's one of the most viciously active chemicals known.
While Paris half-heartedly prepared for a German attack it never believed would come, the French nuclear team went on trying to produce atomic power. Their progress was nil, until one of them had the bright idea of using so-called heavy water in their chain reaction. At that time, in early 1940, the world's sole source of heavy water was here at Rjukan in central Norway. Tipped off that the Germans were beginning to take an interest in it, and hence could be on the same tack as himself, Frédéric Joliot-Curie persuaded the French Secret Service, in one of the most bizarre espionage episodes of the whole Second World War, to snatch the world's total stock of heavy water from under German noses only weeks before they overran Norway. But no sooner had the French scientists begun using the heavy water than France itself was threatened by Hitler's sudden advance into the Low Countries in May 1940. As the panzers approached Paris, the vital heavy water was taken south, first to Clermont-Ferrand, where it was hidden in a women's prison. And then, when France's collapse was certain, the British persuaded the French to ship it to Britain. Arriving at Bordeaux just the day before Marshal Pétain took over France, the heavy water made its way to safety on a battered British coaler, which barely missed being mined in the Bay of Biscay. While the air battle for Britain raged fiercely, teams of scientists got down to the hard theoretical slog of perfecting the bomb, though at times their working conditions bordered on the ludicrous.
By the middle of 1940, I think we're really all out for it, working almost day and night. But by that time, some other difficulties arose. You see, this is the time when Britain became very conscious of the war. This is after Dunkirk. And although I've been working on perhaps the most secret project in the war, I was still an alien, and there were certain rules applying to me. For example, the curfew, I was not allowed out outdoors in the after dusk. And so often when I worked late in the lab, I had to smuggle my way through home in the fear of being arrested on the way. Of course, not allowed to have a bicycle or a car, not allowed to, have any maps, or had to have a special permit each time I wanted to leave Liverpool.
Thanks to these refugee scientists working in beleaguered Britain, by mid-1941, the basic theoretical work on a uranium bomb had been virtually completed, such that when the so-called Maud Committee, set up to supervise the research, reported to Churchill, he gave them the go-ahead to build a pilot plant in North Wales for producing U-235. Said Churchill at the time, "Although personally I'm quite content with the existing explosives, I feel we must not stand in the path of improvement." News had reached him that the Germans had begun assembling their first atomic pile as early as December 1940, though he did not know it had failed miserably. To Churchill in that summer of 1941, with the Russians apparently wilting before the German onslaught and the British Commonwealth being pushed back in the Middle East, anything was worth a gamble. But of course, the United States had not yet come into the war. As a result, American nuclear scientists were not experiencing the same urgency as their British and French confrères. But Pearl Harbor changed all that. Though in point of fact, the official United States decision to expand nuclear research, based on the optimism of the British, preceded the surprise Japanese attack by a few hours. Even so, until Roosevelt and Churchill met in June 1942, the US and Britain continued to pursue separate research paths on the bomb. And the decision then to pool resources still didn't stop the squabbles between the two countries, particularly as to whether the results of the research were to be shared equally after the war. For a time, scientific communication even ceased between the two allies. There was much bitterness, much suspicion, and at least so far as Churchill himself was concerned, much personal anxiety before the terms of that June 1942 agreement were further spelled out at Quebec in August 1943, when the separate British endeavour came to an end and the more important British scientists were absorbed into the American effort. For the most significant result of the earlier discussions between the two leaders had been the coming into being of the Manhattan Project, the code name for the American bomb effort, and so called because initially it was begun under the auspices of the Manhattan District of the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. General Leslie Groves, the man who'd built the Pentagon and ahead of schedule, took charge of the project in September 1942. Told it might cost £25 million, the bill he finally presented the American taxpayer was well over £500 million.
Groves was an impressive person by particularly his courage to take the responsibility for spending vast amounts of money on something that might fail, and he would have been blamed if it had failed.
Well, General Groves was kind of a teddy bear sort, but every time he'd come around to my laboratory, we'd much amuse the general by burning a piece of concrete with fluorine. He just loved that show. And he had many of the aspects of a very intelligent boy. And he was a very stern appearing general and was capable of severe disciplinary measures. And he got his way without exception.
The theoretical work having mostly been done, the major problem was to produce sufficient fissionable material for a bomb. By late 1942, research on three different methods was considered far enough advanced to justify attempting large-scale production. But because it was not so much backing the best method as backing the fastest, in typical American fashion, the decision was taken to go ahead with all three, despite the enormous cost that would entail. Two of them, under Nobel Prize winners Ernest Lawrence of Berkeley, California, the inventor of this, the cyclotron, and Harold Urey of Columbia, New York, involved separating U-235 by the so-called electromagnetic and gaseous diffusion methods. The third, under the direction of yet another Nobel Prize winner, Arthur Compton of Chicago, was to produce plutonium by graphite reactor. Plutonium was an entirely new fissionable material, indeed a new element altogether, which had been discovered almost simultaneously on both sides of the Atlantic by a scientist researching the bomb, though much the greater work on it had been carried out by future Nobel Prize winner Glenn Seaborg. The crucial thing about plutonium was not just that you needed less for a chain reaction than U-235, but that it seemed easier to obtain.
The sample that was isolated as a result of bombarding these hundreds of pounds of uranium with neutrons at Berkeley and St. Louis was finally isolated in pure enough form to weigh a few micrograms by a special balance in which a quartz fiber is suspended at one end and comes out with a weighing pan hanging from that end, and then the sample put on that weighing pan depressed the quartz fiber, and the amount that the quartz fiber went down could be calibrated to correspond to the weight of the sample. And using that, the first sample of plutonium was found to weigh 2.77 micrograms.
2.77 micrograms was less than a millionth of an ounce, while the amount needed for a bomb was a billion times that. Compton was convinced, though, that he could produce the necessary plutonium. The world's first atomic pile for producing plutonium was devised by two brilliant refugee members of Compton's team, Enrico Fermi, the gentle Italian Nobel Prize winner whose wife was Jewish and hence a potential victim of fascist persecution, and Leo Szilard, Hungarian, Jewish, volatile, vain, impetuous, above all, imaginative. Between them, they prepared to make history in a disused rackets court beneath the stands of the University of Chicago's football stadium at Stagg Field. The U.S. Army should have completed a new laboratory for them on the outskirts of Chicago, but had been beset by labor troubles. Compton and co. were too impatient to wait, for rumor had reached them that the authorities were having second thoughts and were considering dropping their method of making material for a bomb to concentrate on the other two. Even so, their decision to risk a chain reaction in the middle of heavily populated Chicago sent General Groves, for one, into a paddy. The idea of a pile was to avoid having to separate the U-235 by simply having a big enough block of uranium that there would be sufficient U-235 already in it to start a chain reaction. To get the necessary uranium, in Canada, the only significant uranium mine in the Western Hemisphere was reopened. But there was still the problem of refining the uranium to the necessary purity for an atomic pile. At Iowa State University, Frank Spedding, a chemist, came up with a new way of producing the metal, albeit a somewhat crude and ramshackle way with its rough retorts and heavy ingots. But, miraculously almost, it worked.
There was a great deal of curiosity on the campus as to what we were doing, particularly as we once in a while one of our retorts would blow up, and with the magnesium, which is what you use in flash powder, it would light up the whole building, and it gave an illusion. The light was so bright that the building swelled up and then sunk back. And the college press office was right across the street from this building, so naturally their curiosity was very great, but nobody would talk, so they didn't know what was going on.
50 tons of uranium went into the pile and 400 tons of graphite. The 50 tons broken down into 22,000 individual uranium slugs, and the 400 tons of graphite sawed and planed and drilled into 40,000 bricks for stacking. Few photographs were taken of that historic occasion, but the artist John Cadell captured the scene for posterity.
Graphite was being received from several manufacturers, and this material, when it arrived, was in rather unusable form, and we set up a machining facility. The word facility is a little bit grand for what we had. We put some machines and some ventilation into a room in the squash court and proceeded to square up the bars and cut them to the right length.
I remember one night when we were pushing these things, we used just ordinary woodworking tools, you see, and we were pushing these through the shop, through the planer. And here was Enrico Fermi, stripped of the lights, pushing these graphite blocks through the shaper. Just glistened, absolutely black, clear to his waist. Well, they're just throwing graphite dust in every direction, you know. He could have had a part in Othello.
December the 2nd, 1942, was a cold winter's day, and the central heating had been switched off under the stands of the football stadium. With the pile now completed, Fermi ordered the test to begin. Inch by inch, the control rods separating the bits of uranium from each other were withdrawn, and the noise at the Geiger counters rose. Near the rail by Fermi's side stood Norman Hilbury with his axe, ready to cut the rope holding the safety rod.
Quite frankly, it never occurred to me the axe would really have to be swung, any more than I am sure it ever occurred to Al Graves and company that they would ever throw these damn bottles down because they saw some glow.
The damn bottles were full of a special solution to flood the pile and stop the reaction if it got out of control.
The last words Fermi said to him was, "Now, if this is the final emergency, if the thing gets away from us, you're to break this." But he said, "I want you to know that you're to watch me, and if I drop dead, then you're to break it. If I'm alive, I'll use this sledgehammer on you."
At a certain point, the safety circuits, which had been set to a certain maximum flux, began to give a bell signal, and that the people wanted still to go a little higher, so they simply pulled the wires off the bell signal so it wouldn't ring. Went a little higher, and then
Enrico said, "Put the control rods in."
But it was quite clear it was the answer of everyone's hopes and dreams. There was absolutely dead silence. Nobody said anything. I'm sure everyone was thinking immediately ahead to the bomb.
But General Groves hadn't waited for the result of the test pile before commissioning the construction of a full-scale plant for producing plutonium.
And I told Compton that the only one that I knew of that could do the job was DuPont. And I talked to the DuPont people, and it was arranged.
Well, I must say that this whole field was so new to us and so strange that we weren't sure whether these people were crazy or whether they weren't. It was completely unprecedented.
The site chosen for the plutonium plant was here at Hanford in the state of Washington, a sandy wasteland on the barren banks of the great majestic Columbia River. 500,000 acres were allotted for the plant, and it was to be the biggest construction project in United States history. For as well as a production complex, there was a whole new town to be built too. 50,000 men were recruited for the task. Few, very few, were told what they were actually making. The construction camp was the largest the West had ever seen. It was also one of the roughest. The plant's purpose was to produce plutonium, a mineral that no one had ever seen and whose properties were still unknown. To date, only millionths of an ounce had been obtained in the laboratory, whereas the task now was to produce many, many pounds, perhaps the greatest scale-up ever attempted by chemists and engineers. Although the men and women, of course, working at Hanford came from almost every state in the Union, people from two states were specifically barred, Tennessee and New Mexico. In their near obsession with security, the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers feared that residents from these two states going to Hanford might see a link between what was happening there and what was already emerging on two other sites, in Tennessee and New Mexico. For at Oak Ridge, Tennessee, between the Great Smoky Mountains and the Cumberland Plateau, on a 54,000-acre plot, another new township and vast sprawling production complex was beginning to take shape, this time for the separation of U-235. Described by some as the most fantastic technological facility ever devised by man, the amount of electricity needed for just one of the Oak Ridge plants was more than that used by cities the size of Boston, USA, or Birmingham, England. Everything was on a gigantic scale. The electromagnets to separate the U-235 were 100 times bigger than any previously known. When it was discovered there wasn't enough copper to service them, pure silver bullion was used instead, 15,000 tons of it, borrowed by the Army from the U.S. Treasury for the war's duration. The floor of just one of the buildings covered 44 acres of ground and was 4 stories high. Needless to say, it was the largest building ever constructed.
The development of an industry the size of Detroit in 2 years was what we accomplished. And it is almost unbelievable, but it happened.
Research hitherto had been concentrated on producing the fissionable materials for a bomb. As yet, no one was working on the physical problems of actually making a bomb. Indeed, making a bomb was not strictly within General Grove's brief. In the autumn of 1942, a colleague of Ernest Lawrence's at Berkeley, California, persuaded Groves to set up a separate bomb laboratory at some remote spot. His name was J. Robert Oppenheimer, and his of all was the name destined to be most linked with the atom bomb story. Groves had wanted Oppenheimer to lead the bomb laboratory from the start, but the FBI refused to give him a security clearance on account of his having associated with left-wingers in the 30s. In the end, Groves took it on himself to clear Oppenheimer and to go on clearing Oppenheimer, even when the FBI came up with what they claimed was new evidence of his continuing associations with communists, a gesture which, after the war, brought Groves much criticism in certain quarters of American life. Even today, Oppenheimer remains a controversial figure, an enigma to many.
Gentle, sort of a philosopher type, always thinking rather than doing things. But nevertheless, he had also a very great strength of character, and the main thing was that scientists trusted him.
Oppenheimer was highly respected by most people and proved to be a marvelous director of a place like that. He managed to keep the confidence of all the people there, managed to keep them together, and also to handle the army side of things. The scientists and the army were not always easily compatible.
Oppenheimer had two great passions in life, physics and these the mountains and deserts of New Mexico. His work on the atom bomb was to bring these two passions together. For more than a decade, he'd rented a ranch high up in these, the Sangre de Cristo mountains of New Mexico, and had holidayed there every year, So when General Groves asked him to suggest a site for his bomb laboratory, it was perhaps natural he should want to locate it in his favorite part of the United States, in particular, his favorite part of New Mexico. His exploring the area around his ranch had often brought him to an isolated plateau in a deep canyon of the Rio Grande. Atop this plateau was a boys' school, the Los Alamos Ranch School, whose log cabins were scattered amid cottonwood trees 8,500 feet above sea level. To Oppenheimer, it was a place to stir the imagination, a place to think and to work uninterrupted by city and other war cares, which is what he argued to the committee who traveled out to vet the site.
The date of that trip was November 16, 1942. This cold afternoon with the boys and their masters out in their shorts playing ball in the fields with a light snowstorm going on. It was a rather striking scene, which I well remember. General Groves immediately said, this is a suitable site. And the legal processes for acquiring it were initiated immediately. I think the very same day or the very next day. And construction started in December. Things moved very fast. So that was the beginning of Los Alamos.
It was a dusty, ugly, austere settlement that emerged atop that isolated plateau in New Mexico. A composite of log cabins left over from the school and shoddy, temporary barrack-type buildings put up quickly by the army. But there was the compensation of some of the most breathtaking scenery the Far West had to offer. Site Y, as Los Alamos was known to the military, was much smaller, of course, than the Manhattan Project's other secret cities. But like Oak Ridge and Hanford, its name didn't adorn any map or letterhead. Its address was simply Post Office Box 1663, Santa Fe. An address that appeared on numerous birth certificates, too, as the young wives of the scientists took advantage of the free health services and the population soared. Oppenheimer's team began arriving in the spring of 1943. It was an impressive one, eventually 5,000 strong. The best possible nuclear scientists the Allies could muster. As General Groves was later to say, not necessarily in jest, here we assemble the greatest bunch of prima donnas ever seen in one place.
Intellectually, it was something out of this world. I mean, you had there the best brains in the world to talk to discuss any matters. You sat down for lunch, and the chances were that half a dozen Nobel Prize winners will sit at the same table.
There were fabulous possibilities for work. Anything we wanted had double X priority.
There was a little annoyances from censorship and so forth, and checking in at gates and all kinds of things. But it was understandable that such a thing had to go. In fact, most of the complaints was that the security was rather lax in places. There would be big holes in the outside fence that a man could walk through standing up. And I used to enjoy going out through the gate, coming in through the fence hole, and going out through the gate again and in through the fence hole until the poor sergeant at the gate would gradually realize that this guy has come out of the place four times without going in once, and he'd kind of arrest me, sort of.
It was a place where very many friendships were made, and you could occasionally get some friction arising. Perhaps the trouble that came many years later over the Oppenheimer affair goes back to personal relationships developed at that time.
Almost all the papers which he had, documents, were classified, were top secret. Therefore, we were told they must be kept in special safes, special cabinets, and have to be locked up. But of course, scientists used to forget about locking up. And anybody could go around afterwards and see what the other colleagues had been doing. So they provided us with other types of safes, which had a combination lock. You don't have any key at all, because you used to lose the keys. And just to have to put on a number, combination number for three digits, to open it. Of course, what did scientists do to try to remember this number? They had to use some number which was on their mind. And as it turned out afterwards, that about three quarters of all the safes had the same combination, 235. This is the uranium 235, which was we've been working. So Bangor security again.
In September 1944, the first of Hanford's three reactors went critical. But barely 6 hours later, it stopped, and was not in operation again until the end of the year. Meantime, the second reactor had begun working, and by February 1945, the third one was operating too. In that same month, the first small sample of plutonium reached Los Alamos from Hanford. Thereafter, it came in twice a week, making the long road journey to New Mexico in a heavily guarded ambulance. It was not until March 1945 that Oak Ridge began offering any U-235. But what of the Germans? When the great Danish nuclear scientist Niels Bohr escaped to England in late 1943, he confirmed earlier intelligence reports that they too were definitely working on an atom bomb.
The thought that the Germans might be ahead of us in this project was a terribly frightening possibility. We tried by sort of private enterprise to see what picture we could get from published information, from the German scientific literature, from lecture lists of people lecturing in physics in German universities and so on. And we came to the conclusion, which turned out to be right, that there was probably some work going on, and we could pinpoint the names of a few people who were likely to be connected with that, but no major effort, no general movement of all physicists to, away from universities to special projects, as was the case here and in the United States. So there was a small-scale effort on, but not a big one. And this later turned out to be right, but we were afraid of relying on that information.
Alarm struck the scientific teams when it was learned that the Germans had suddenly tripled their heavy water requirements from the Norwegian plant. Something clearly was up and had to be stopped. An early commando attack on the plant failed, but a later one in 1943 partly succeeded, and thereafter, Allied planes regularly pounded the place, such that when the Germans realized they had little hope of continuing production there, they ordered the entire stock of heavy water to be shipped to Germany. But Norwegian saboteurs made sure it never reached its destination. Even so, why, when they had such a head start, the German scientists failed to make a bomb, continues to puzzle.
Well, I think there were several reasons. One is that some of them undoubtedly didn't want to help the Nazis develop a frightful weapon like that. Others were perhaps willing to do so, but were very scared of what might happen to them if they failed, so they preferred not to start. Then there were some who were quite keen to try, but they soon started squabbling among each other as to who was doing what, and as a result, facilities were badly divided between them and efforts were duplicated.
But at the time, the Allied bomb scientists at Los Alamos didn't know of the Germans' problems. They had enough of their own.
The big technical problem is rapid assembly. One has fissional material which, if put together in a supercritical mass, will undergo a chain reaction and explode, while if it's separated, will not. The problem is to have a separated mass of material and move it rapidly together into the supercritical configuration so that it will go off.
The ideas of doing it by banging it together with high explosive, the simple-minded way of doing it, wasn't working. The explosive interacted with itself, and it you may squeeze in one place, but it's shut out somewhere else.
So there was this mechanical problem, and this simple, obvious way to do this is by shooting pieces of material out of a gun so that they come together at the speed of a projectile. And that was the initial mode of assembly which was worked on. The other mode, which turned out in the end to be much more successful, was the implosion method, where the high explosive pushes the material in by the direct action of the high explosive without going through the interposition of a gun barrel and all this machinery.
The suggestion to make a new way of doing it with high explosive was not received very, very excitedly at first, but it gradually gained ground. In the meantime, despair reigned, I would say, for the next year. But this work was done in increasing amounts on this other way of doing it, and it gradually
caused encouragement. I would describe the situation as a gradual and very slowly rising optimism. And even at the very end, we weren't sure. You could only find out if you were doing this assembly by firing it. It's not no easy matter to look inside a very powerful explosion and see if you put things together right.
It had been realized early on that a test firing would be necessary, and Oppenheimer had long selected a possible firing site here in the southern part of New Mexico, some 300 miles from Los Alamos, the desert area known appropriately enough as Jornada del Muerto, Journey of Death, a grim, arid wasteland that had got its name from the countless Spanish pioneers who had perished crossing it. Throughout 1944 and early 1945, preparations went on for Project Trinity, as Oppenheimer chose to call the first test firing of an atom bomb. It meant the building of new roads across the desert, of bunkers to house the testing equipment, above all, the erection of a 100-foot steel tower from which the weapon would be exploded. The temperature of that explosion was expected to be the hottest the world had ever known, but the 90 degrees heat of the New Mexico desert was bad enough for the men working there. The success of the firing was in such doubt that many wondered whether it was worth wasting the precious plutonium. And so it was decided at first to contain the explosion in this massive steel chamber, inevitably nicknamed Jumbo. 25 feet long, 12 feet in diameter, its walls were 14 inches thick and it weighed well over 200 tons. In the end, when it was pointed out that if the explosion was successful, Jumbo would certainly shatter and endanger the testing equipment, the million-pound steel colossus was never used. By July the 13th, 1945, it was a Friday the 13th, all was ready at the Trinity site. Enough plutonium for the test had arrived, brought without ceremony in the back of an army sedan. The general in charge of the site duly signed a receipt for it, and the final assembly of the world's first atom bomb took place inside a canvas tent at the foot of the steel tower. By late afternoon on July the 14th, the bomb, nicknamed Fat Man on account of its broad shape, was in place on top of the tower. It was on July the 14th, too, that the main components of Little Boy, as the uranium bomb had been dubbed, began their journey from Los Alamos to the Pacific island of Tinian, where the B-29 bombers had been training for the coming raid on Japan. There was still barely enough U-235 for one bomb, and because its gun-exploding mechanism was simpler than the implosion idea of the plutonium bomb, a test firing was thought a luxury. All day, Sunday, July the 15th, the weather was bad at Jornada del Muerto. Nerves were tense. Many of the scientists still had doubts.
I thought maybe nature is cleverer than we and that something is going to go a little more complicated than we thought, and it would fizzle out a little bit or something like that.
We people who were supposed to have made contributions to the operation were taken there in three buses. We left, it's about 300 miles from here, we left in the early afternoon. We were chattering as scientists do, and there were of course another group already there who were on the ground doing the instrumentation. And I remember it as a jolly, carefree people going to see the end of it all. And then it happened. It was in the early dawn.
When I saw the real explosion and heard the loud noise 20 miles away, I knew that the thing worked just exactly as it was designed.
It was a rather eerie experience, and having been up all night, people were tired, they were somewhat overcome. There wasn't a great deal of jubilation. People were pleased that it had been a technical success.
It lowered a curtain over all of us. We slowly got into our buses and prepared to come back, and for 3 or 4 hours, I swear, hardly a word was spoken. It was, I think that's the best illustration of what it did to us.
Even the official army report of the test seemed unusually affected. Said the general writing it, "No man-made phenomenon of such tremendous power had ever occurred before. The whole country was lit by a searing light with the intensity many times that of the midday sun, followed almost immediately by the strong, sustained, awesome roar which warned of doomsday. Typically, and more graphically, Oppenheimer turned to his Sanskrit, to his favorite, Krishna. I am become death, the shatterer of worlds. 21 days later, on August the 6th, 1945, the world was shattered when the first uranium bomb fell on Hiroshima, and the great debate began.
Feelings really were aroused when I suddenly heard great shouting and people running through the corridors and telephones picked up to book tables to celebrate, and I felt a bit sick at the thought that people celebrated the instantaneous killing of some 100,000 or so.
There was at Los Alamos a great elation. Everybody was running around and dancing and singing and being very wild because they had been working on some kind of a thing and they succeeded. Here and there was an individual would stand in a hall and look morose and say, this is a terrible thing. But we'd all forgotten what a terrible thing it was, and I thought he was fooling. But I realize now he was one of the few sensible people in the mad excitement.